It is said that if you want to be heard, you tell a story.
Ogoni is 404 square miles and has one of the highest population density in the world. And that is the same location that we have 96 oil wells with gas flaring taking place 24 hours of the day for over 35 years. That gas flaring was leading to the warming of the Ogoni environment. Of course, Shell dismissed it, but we noticed incidences of floods, which was of course not known to the environment. People have lost their homes, lost their means of livelihood, or they can no longer go to fish, they can no longer go to farm, or people even die in the course of moving from one location to the other.
In this climate crisis, what are the duties of states? States, in Roman law, bonus pater familias, good father of the family of humankind and of life itself. So we want to ask them a question. What are your duties to present and future generations?
So we all know this for a fact, and you know, Fiji continues to face such devastation.
Being in spaces like this, where you can talk about these experiences with other people that are doing similar things, would make you understand that you're not alone and that there are other people in the fight with you.
I'm an indigenous person from Siberia, Russia. My people call themselves forest people. The main reason why I'm here, it's deforestation of Siberia, Siberian fires, and many, many environmental problems which exist in my region. My people and mostly all indigenous groups in Russia are small numbered, and they live in very, very remote areas. And because of climate change, they need to migrate, they need to change their activity. And if we don't act right now, if we don't scream about problem, we will not exist in 10 years if rivers are not there, if wetlands are not there, my people are also not there. For me, it means just my home. It's very, like, it's very mine. It's my community, it's my relatives. I cannot just leave it.
Eu lhes diria que sobre o clima não há uma negociação. Infelizmente, não temos um outro lugar com condições para podermos viver. Para dizer que podemos destruir o mundo, o planeta Terra, e possamos ir viver em outro lugar. Então, o que eu gostaria de chamar a atenção, fazer chegar uma mensagem aos líderes mundiais, é que consideremos que esta Terra a recebemos por empréstimo dos nossos avós. E temos que passá-lo nas condições melhores ainda aos nossos filhos e netos. Então, é uma responsabilidade.
The impacts of climate change, I mean, we live by it day by day. Our lands get washed away day by day, every high tide, every monsoon season, we lose land. And, you know, our islands are getting smaller and smaller and smaller until we have to leave some of our sandbanks. You know, the birds that go past, they can't rest there anymore, and some of the species back home are our totems, you know, which gives us direction in life, and it's very close and personal to us.
For me, it's about protecting my island, and like it's bigger than anything else. It's something that's, it's a personal battle for me, it's a personal journey. It's my connection to my land and my sea, and also for my family, and to making sure that my grandchildren and their children still remain on our lands and keep practicing our cultures and traditions on land, and to make sure that we don't have to move away and leave my ancestors buried back on the islands if they are to sink because of the rising sea levels.
My grandfather told me, and he always uses this quote, he always says, the elders have told him, and about the sea, they said, "Inomal, nitamunya dainga, mamo yawaikarue."
Sometimes you can be locked up in your own world, believing that you are alone in this struggle.
Audre Lorde said, and I quote, "We don't live single issue lives. We live multiple intersecting lives, and that's the beauty about it."
At the end of the day, if we're just going to continue working in our silos and not really recognizing the intersectionality with environmental justice, climate justice, gender, human rights, like disability rights, like everything is so integrated that it's impossible to achieve any of these missions on our own.
We are here on a charm campaign. We're gathering young people from around the world. We must make our voices heard.
So we see that there is hopeless among the youth. But at the same time, that youngsters led by Greta, a 6 years old school girl, has ignited the fire within the youngsters. And that is a hope for the future. So it is, I think, this is, good, the inspiration to people. And it is hopes created among we elders, especially we activities, having a dream of a planet without destruction, a planet without disaster, a planet without inequality.
So for the young people around the world, I want to say that you're not alone out there. We're all fighting the same fight that you are fighting as well.
I was able to journey out and really see, to really find my true self. We all are beacons of hope, and we all have that urge of activism to stop such injustice in every place we go to. It's about human rights for everyone, and not just for some group of people. We are not cherry picking which human rights we're gonna talk about and who are we gonna put at the front line. Honey, when climate change is striking right now, it's affecting everyone, all groups of people, all kinds of human beings and species on this planet. And so it's really about being real.
It's just about love. It's everything about love.
Questions are very powerful. If you want to be heard, you tell a story. People like listening to stories. If you want to touch the heart, sing a song. If you want to start a revolution, ask a question.